Sand's real. Ashgrove. All right.
And welcome to Hempfield Church of the Brethren. It's good to see you. If anybody is visiting and this is your first time here, we do have a nice little gift bag that we'd like to send home with you, and you can pick that up on your way out. It's in the narthex, and we're glad to have you here. Thank you, musicians, for that lovely Irish music. Having a grandmother, McFarland, I do appreciate all things Irish. And now Donna has an announcement for us regarding the library.
Okay, how many of you know where the library is? Or that we even have a library? That's what I thought. Of course, in this day of technology, who uses libraries anymore, right? We do have one, and it's over there. Just go back the hallway and to the right. There are plenty of books. People will say they're old books. Yes, they are. People will say they're outdated. Yes, some of them are. But you know, not all of them. How old is the Bible? And we still read that, right? So take some time, go back there. Look, you're welcome to take books out and borrow them. However, because we said there are a lot of outdated books and the library was kind of messy and it became a dumpy ground for some things, so the education team has taken upon themselves to start going through it. It's going to be a long process, so don't expect it to be clean tomorrow because it's not gonna happen, but we did start. We tackled one corner and so that one corner, we tossed out. We gave to somebody else to look through. Or in John Knox Hall, you will see two tables of books. So please take some time, go over there. There's all kinds of things. There's fiction books. There's biblical text type things. There's some Brethren history. There's a cookbook. There's all kinds of things. If you see anything that suits your fancy, please take it. It'll be over there for about 2 weeks, and after that, we're going to donate it to the library. So, like I said, take use of our library or help yourself to some books over there. I found some in the library that I'm going to take out to read. It was really interesting. And for those of you who have children or parents, upstairs, how many of you know that there is a shelf upstairs for kids? So you're welcome to take those books out. That's what they're there for. So please take advantage of the books and get off your Kindles and your phones. Thank you.
Okay, some further announcements. There is a Thursday morning ladies' Bible study going on. We did order materials and they have arrived. And if anyone didn't have the opportunity to sign up yet and still would like to come, we did order some extras. So just Sue Brubaker is going to be out after the service at the table in the narthex. Just see her. We'd love to have you join us. It starts March 30th, and I'm excited to announce that there is another opportunity for ladies. Some of you can't join us on a Thursday morning. There is now a Friday morning Bible study that's going to start March 31st. That is six sessions. It's Lisa Turkhurst. It's her latest book. It will be excellent. We have enjoyed doing some of her studies in the past. So if you are available on a Friday morning, this one is Zoom or in person. So if you can't show up at church, please see Jen Hinton, and she will make sure that you get on a Zoom and that you can join the ladies. So I hope you take advantage of that. The ladies' Bible study has been such a blessing in my life. We have cried together. We've rejoiced together. We've studied God's word and grown together. So I hope more ladies can take advantage of joining a small ladies group now that we have two groups available. I also want to draw your attention to two more announcements that are in your bulletin. You can read for further details. Next Sunday, right after church, we are going to have a fun time to celebrate our church. It is a meal. You can read the menu. Sounds great. And there's gluten-free for those who need gluten-free options. That will be available. And if you can stay afterwards, we can have a lot of fun fellowshipping and stuffing over 2,000 eggs for the Easter egg hunt, which is coming up next Saturday, April 1st. So that'll be coming up soon, next Saturday. Not this coming Saturday, but the following Saturday. And the details are in your bulletin for that. So we hope those are two things that everyone can take advantage of and enjoy as a church family. We're awaiting the arrival of the gentleman who was going to talk to us about Church World Services. I don't believe he's shown up yet, so hopefully we can slip him in later in the service. So with that said, we're going to go to our opening prayer and our call to worship. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can call you Abba Daddy. We so need that right now. To have a loving Father in our lives is so important. And we thank you that we can always come to you, that your love is everlasting, that you welcome us with open arms, no matter what we've done, no matter where we've been. We are welcome in your kingdom, Lord. We thank you for that. We thank you for the privilege it is, not the duty, but the privilege to come here, join together, and worship you. Thank you for our church family. We thank you for the gifts that they are sharing today, for the music, for the leadership, for the sermon. We await in eager anticipation to meet with you at this time. In Jesus' name, amen. For our call to worship, we're turning to the Gospel of John, chapter 13, and verses 34 and 35. And I'm so thankful that Pastor Doug allowed me to choose the version I wanted to read out of. I typically read numerous versions and pick out one that impacts me the most. So today I'm going to be using the New Living Translation. And Jesus is talking. It's important to get the context of this. They have sat down to a meal. These verses, Jesus speaks after the meal, after he has washed the disciples' feet. And very importantly, he has now showed the disciples the full extent of his love. And then he tells them, "So now I am giving you a new commandment, love each other, just as I have loved you." And he just demonstrated that love by washing his disciples' feet. Think about that. What that means to have Jesus wash your feet, and how he's saying that's how we need to love each other, that we're willing to wash each other's feet. So, love each other just as I have loved you. You should love each other. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples. And that word prove really hit me this week. There is proof that we are his disciples. And that proof is how we love each other. And I just want to tell you a little bit of my story. I'll try to keep it brief. But on July 18th, 1971, I attended the first Jesus rally in Lancaster County. And it was none other than our beloved pastor, Bill Longenecker's farm. Yes, yeah. That is how forward-thinking that man was. He didn't care that these people that were coming to speak were former drug addicts, came from New York City. They had not lived the life that I had lived at all. He was willing to let them speak to people in Lancaster County, people, youth from his church. And I had grown up in the church. I was the cradle baby. You know, I never knew anything but church. And so at 12 years old, when you normally do, you go through membership class, and then you're asked if you're ready to join the church and be baptized. And of course, that's what you did. So I did that. So if anybody would ask me, "Are you a Christian?" Well, yeah, I'm a church member. Of course I'm a Christian. But when I went to that Jesus rally and I listened to those hippies, which they were, from New York City, talk about their relationship with Jesus, I kept thinking, huh, they've got something I don't have. Yes, I've been raised in the church. Yes, I'm a member of the church. Yes, I know all about Jesus. Loved him, but didn't have a personal relationship. So that day, at that first Jesus rally in Lancaster County, I accepted Christ, even though I had been a member of the Church of the Brethren for years. And Rich and I just recently attended the Jesus Revolution movie at Penn Cinema, and I highly recommend that movie. For me, it was history. It was my history. And they even talked about Expo 72 in Dallas, Texas. I had been there, where Campus Crusade had the biggest Jesus rally to that time. And you know, I got to see Billy Graham speak and Chris Christopherson give his testimony and Johnny Cash and his wife sing. And so it was a really exciting time in my life. And so it was neat to see actual footage from Expo 72. I wasn't in it, unfortunately. I was thinking, oh, I wonder if I'm in any of the shots, but I wasn't. But anyhow, I highly recommend, go to that movie. I know most of you are too young but to know anything about the Jesus Revolution in the 70s, but hey, ask your parents, ask your grandparents, ask them how it impacted them. Did they know about it? For me, it was my saving grace and how I met the Lord. So very important time in my life. So I do see that Andrew is now here. So I'm going to invite him up before the praise band sings. And I also wanted to mention one thing about music here. One of the important songs of that time to me, and one we sang regularly, was "They'll Know We Are Christians by Our Love." And just as Jesus said, that's the proof that you're my disciples, if you love one another. That song meant a lot to me, and our praise band has a phenomenal rendition of that, and I have been told that they will sing it soon. No time today to do it, but they will be singing it soon, and I hope you're here for it, because it's phenomenal, and it is our theme. They'll know we are Christians by our love. Andrew?
Yes, on behalf of the outreach team, we just wanted to invite, every month we try to focus on the different outreach organizations as well as events that we have to sponsor. We just welcome Andrew here this morning. He's from Church World Services. So, you know, over the last year, we've been collecting items really for our refugees that are being housed in the Lancaster area. So I'm going to let Andrew share a little bit more about that.
Oh, thank you. Yes, Andrew is here. Andrew is also apologetic for not being here earlier. As I was walking out the door to get here, my soon-to-be three-year-old thought, now's a good time to just throw things all over the house and throw a huge, big temper tantrum. And my wife just takes this one look at me and says, please help. Don't go. Just not yet. I'm sure the lovely people at Hempfield will understand. And so, yes, I am here, and it is wonderful to be here. My name is Andrew. I am, actually, my title just changed recently. I think it's Community Sponsorship Developer or something like that, at Church World Service, an organization that you all have quite a bit of familiarity with, I'm sure, in terms of what it is that we do, what is our mission and vision, and how do we try to, in any way that we can, make Lancaster County a more diverse and just enjoyable place to live and be refuge for those who are seeking safety from violence, persecution, and oppression all around the world. This is an interesting week, actually, at Church World Service. We moved offices this week after probably decades on the 300 block of East King Street. We actually moved a whole block down to the 400 block of East King Street. But what was so fascinating was obviously in the spirit of packing and moving, you start to dust off some old things. You go through old files, and I found something this week. I found... No joke, it was like on Tuesday of this week, I found, and I'm not gonna like show it necessarily, but I'll just, so this is a survey. This was a survey that was filled out by someone from Hempfield Church of the Brethren 13 years ago. I was instructed by my wife not to read the answers verbatim in front of you all. However, I looked over this survey from someone in this church who, essentially formed a team of people to welcome a refugee family. You probably know who the refugee family is. You probably know who even filled out the survey. I don't know. And you were maybe you even were a part of that core group that worked with that family almost a decade and a half ago. But what was so interesting in reading these different answers of, you know, what went well, what didn't go so well, what was frustrating, what was life-giving, how could we improve things? the answers really reminded me of parenting a two-year-old. And I don't mean that to say that refugees are like children. That is not what I'm saying. My point is, when my almost three-year-old, his name's Simon, and my six-year-old's name is Theodore, so if you guys have any ideas of what the third one could be named, let me know. That joke gets works every time. You know, when he draws something, let's say he was trying to draw a house with us, mommy, daddy, Theo, Simon in it, and he shows it to me, and it's like just a complete mess, right? It's scribbles. If he's coloring something, it's probably outside the lines. It's not a perfect square. But if you are a parent, you know that at the end of the day, is it a hot mess? Yes. But it is also the most beautiful thing you've ever seen. A beautiful mess is completely how I would describe the world that is refugee resettlement. It is a mess. Things don't go the way that we want them to go. People miss doctor's appointments, or there's miscommunication between a family who is just trying to understand what it means to live in a new environment and not speak English, and people who have lived here their entire lives. Things just go wrong. There's, an unknown or unforeseen roach infestation in the apartment that they're living in Lancaster City, right? And so when I look at this survey, there's a question on here about what surprised you about, you know, what we would call sponsorship, sponsoring a family. And this is the only answer I'll give from this survey, in big capital letters with a lot of exclamation points, everything. But at the same time, reflecting on everything that, you know, did go wrong, could go wrong, because that is life, right? That did go wrong, could go wrong. At the end of the day, this family also were able to bring in new life into the world while they were here. They were able to give birth to a baby while they were here within the first few months. It is a beautiful mess. The lows are really low. When I get a call from a volunteer at, I was watching, it was the NFC Championship game the Eagles were playing in a couple months ago. And I got a call from a volunteer at a church who was working with a Congolese family at, 8:30 or 9 o'clock. My kids were already in bed. And they basically said, there is a domestic dispute here. What should I do? Should I take the mother and the kids into my house? But at the same time, I can go into work the next day and find volunteers and churches who have embraced and really brought healing to families who are just seeking safety and refuge. The lows are very low, but the highs are worth it every single time. So I will leave you with just a very brief video about what is new at Churchwood Service. What's going on? There's been a lot of change in these last 13 years since this survey was filled out. But at the same time, it is also important to know that we are looking to resettle more refugees this upcoming year than we have in the last 20 years. So when people ask me, is there a need? Absolutely. There always is, and I pray that there always will be, because we've seen times when it hasn't. So I certainly invite and express appreciation and thanks for all the support that this church has given, at least in my short 2-year stint now at Church World Service. I invite you to think about and grasp about what it could mean to possibly take the next step and do something you maybe haven't done in 13 years and work with another family. I don't know. That's something I think, maybe God is inviting you to pray and discern for in this new generation and era. But I will leave you with this, and I just want to say thanks. I really appreciate all the support. Thank you.
Church World Services is welcoming new neighbors into a new life, a new opportunity to build themselves back up again.
We help in a lot of ways as volunteers. Number one's probably transportation when they first get here. We go, you know, take them to their doctor appointments, the clothing bank, grocery shopping, any other places that they need to go.
It could be welcoming a family, taking on a family, taking on an individual.
I was a refugee, I need help. You learn from people. How can I learn how to drive? I never drive in my country. How to apply for a job?
If you have no car, no work. This one's the first, like, for refugee people's heart.
Having volunteer a big help.
Probably the most gratifying piece of being a volunteer with Church World Service is just helping people, meeting people. I've learned so much over the years that I've been with Church World Service, and the learning never stops.
What do I get out of volunteering? I get more than I ever even imagined.
It's amazing to have a volunteer. Without volunteer, you know, everything gonna be so different, because volunteers, the people that know everything.
It's important to take the time and take the time to listen if someone does want to tell you their story. A lot of them come here and they don't have any connections to this area, and we're their first friends.
The people give you, at least they cannot give you anything, they just give you a smile. You know, that feels so amazing.
We have so much to be thankful for. You think you're gonna understand what the volunteer experience is about, but I feel like I've learned more than new neighbors.
Thank you, Andrew. Would you please stand and join us now as we lift our hearts and voices to God?
Thank you.
Thank you, Praise Band. And the children are now invited to Children's Church. So, and as you go, Lord, we ask that you be with them. Help them to soak up your truths as they listen to the teachers upstairs. Thank you for the future of our church. In Jesus' name. I just wanted to mention you're seeing something a little different today. We made a change. I am standing down on your level to lead worship. Normally that doesn't happen, but as a person who has a trick knee that sometimes unexpectedly goes out on them, trust me, steps are not my friend, and I didn't want you to witness me tumbling down the steps because I knew when I got up this morning my knee is really not happy today. So I'm hoping you're okay with this change. I know we always say about how many brethren does it take to change a light bulb? Change? What? Wait a minute, change? So I'm hoping this change is okay because there are other worship leaders like me who do not negotiate steps very well, especially without a railing. So if it's okay, but if you have any concerns or if there's anything that's not working quite right, just let us know, because I know for me, this is a beneficial change, even though that's hard to do. Our next scripture that we're reading, our Old Testament scripture, is Leviticus 19, 9 to 18. And you have heard people say, oh, the Bible is just a book of do nots. Do not do this. Do not do that. Well, Leviticus is one of those books, and this is one of those scriptures. But at the very last verse in 19, you'll hear the reason why we do not do these things. And it's a very important reason, and it goes along with our theme for today. So, Leviticus 19, 9 to 18. When you harvest your crops, do not harvest the grain along the edges of your fields, and do not pick up what the harvesters drop. It is the same with your grape crop. Do not strip every last bunch of grapes from the vines, and do not pick up the grapes that fall to the ground. Leave them for the poor and the foreigners who live among you, for I am the Lord your God. Do not steal. Do not cheat one another. Do not lie. Do not use my name to swear a falsehood and so profane the name of your God. I am the Lord. Do not cheat or rob anyone. Always pay your hard workers promptly. Show your fear of God by treating the deaf with respect and by not taking advantage of the blind. I am the Lord. Always judge your neighbors fairly, neither favoring the poor nor showing deference to the rich. Do not spread slanderous gossip among your people. Do not try to get ahead at the cost of your neighbor's life, for I am the Lord. Do not nurse hatred in your heart for any of your relatives. Confront your neighbors directly so that you will not be guilty for their crimes. Never seek revenge or bear a grudge against anyone, but love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time with you. We thank you that you are an awesome God, but we especially thank you that you are a God that gives us everlasting love. We never have to worry that we're too awful, that we've done something too bad. You will still love us. We are your children. Thank you for that assurance, Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you that we can always come to you, no matter what. Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you for our family in this church. We thank you for those who are gathering with us today, and we hope that they feel at home here. Lord, we thank you for Pastor Doug and for the words that you have given him to relay to us. May we have open ears and especially open hearts so that we don't just hear your word, but we understand it, we take it to heart, and we live differently this week because we have been here. Lord, we pray for those that are suffering in our congregation. You know those who are ill. You know those who have physical struggles, emotional struggles, mental struggles, Lord. Life is hard, but you are with us, and you have a plan for our lives, Lord, and may we open ourselves up to that plan. Show us where we need to go, who we need to see, what we need to do so that we can heal and be a light and salt to the world because you have healed us and we can go forth loving others as you have loved us. Lord, we pray for the refugees in our midst. Show us what we need to do to help them. We thank you for Andrew and World Services and for their constant care for these people. And even though times are tough and things happen that we wish didn't, Lord, we thank you for perseverance. And we thank you for the difference that has been made in these refugees' lives. Lord, we think of our dear brothers and sisters in other parts of the world who are persecuted just because they name you as Lord and Savior and name you as their God. Lord, we pray that you would protect them, but give them joy, Lord. Give them joy in the midst of suffering because your joy is our strength. So we ask you to strengthen them. We pray for our dear brothers and sisters in Ukraine who are experiencing the horrors of war, Lord. Lord, we ask that it would come to an end, but we ask that you give them strength. We thank you that more believers are coming to know you because of the war. They're seeing that you are God and that they need you in their lives, Lord. We thank you for all that you're doing in the world, even though sometimes it looks so bleak and dark, Lord. Many good things are happening because your people are serving each other in love and serving our world in love. Help us to be your hands and feet as we go forward out of this sanctuary. In Jesus' name, we ask these things and we pray as you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You dwell in the shelter of the
Thank you, choir. What a beautiful reminder of how God cares for us. Very touching. Our New Testament scripture today is from Colossians 3, 12 to 17. And just like our Old Testament was about the do-nots, this scripture is about what we must do. So, and I chose this translation because it uses the word must. This is not optional stuff, folks. This is the things that we must do. So listen as we hear the things that we must do. Since God chose you to be the holy people whom he loves, you must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. You must make allowances for each other's faults and forgive the person who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. And the most important piece of clothing you must wear is love. Love is what binds us all together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you are all called to live in peace and always be thankful. Let the words of Christ in all their richness live in your hearts and make you wise. Use his words to teach and counsel each other. Sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts. And whatever you do or say, let it be as a representative of the Lord Jesus, all the while giving thanks through him to God the Father. Thank you, Lord, for your word. May we live it.
Morning. Through the season of Lent, we are working through commitment to the vision and mission of Christ, commitment to the vision and mission of Hemphill Church of the Brethren. And I wanted to touch on a couple things as we talk about being committed together to Christ today. On Monday, Thursday, April 6th at 6:30, we will have Love Feast. Now, I know hippies were mentioned earlier. This is different than that. It's a remembrance of the Last Supper. And it will be celebrated much like we did Church World Communion Sunday, where we'll have hand foods. We'll actually do hand washing instead of foot washing. And we'll share in communion. And the deacons will be making the bread. If you would like, if you miss the cups, you can go home and eat a piece of cardboard. But we will be doing that. And then on Good Friday, we will have a tenebrae service where we'll be walking through the last steps of Christ's life here on earth. It will primarily be hymns and scripture. We want to keep the focus where it belongs, which is on him. Easter, of course, is April 9th. And then after Easter, the weeks following Easter, we will be running membership classes. There'll be three or four sessions. I'm going to contact the deacons this week and make sure that we're on the same page. And it will be for people who may be looking to join the church. It will also be for people who may be longtime members and just want to sit in and be reminded of who we are and why we come. We'll share our faith stories. Let me grab this paper quickly. We'll share our faith stories. We'll look at faith practice through a brethren lens in HCOB. And we'll look at Hempfield today. What ministries are happening, where people can partner, where we see God moving. So that will be following after Easter. And then another thing that we'll be following after Easter, the last Sunday of April is the fifth Sunday. On fifth Sundays, we're all together. The children are in the service with us, and we'll be doing an anointing service. And I'll continue to talk about that leading up to that. But anointing is found in the Gospels. It's found throughout the Old Testament. It's found specifically in James 5, where it talks about having the elders of the church pray over you. In that instance, it's in times of sickness. But we also pray over people when they've gone through a life tragedy or they're facing a big decision and they need discernment. We have done it at end of life also, or in the case if a person cannot respond, if the family would like a family member anointed, we've done that as well. So we'll continue to plant seed for that because it can be a powerful service. When we were processing with the worship team, two of our youth leaders were on there and they said the anointing service at the National Youth Conference was one of the most powerful services because our youth got up voluntarily and they got up in unison to go down and be anointed. It is a beautiful time of confession and healing and peace. So there are the broad strokes. And if my voice sounds more like an NPR kind of soothing, I'm partially tired, and I was thinking about this. Daylight savings time. It takes me a week or two to catch up. And in honor of that, I cut 2 inches off of my kitchen table and I glued it on the other side. No, I didn't do that. That would not go over well in my house. So today we're focusing on commitment to Christ together. And these passages, both in the Old Testament, the focus is on God's chosen people, the holy people, that how they're to live as a holy and chosen people. And then in Colossians, it's how believers are to treat one another. And I want to work through both of those passages today, because I think seeing these commandments, especially when we talk about the greatest commandments, the second greatest commandment being love your neighbor as you love yourself, seeing them in context can give us a little more grounding. I think sometimes when we say that, we just assume we know what that means. And whether we want to own this or not, we also assume who we can love and who we don't have to. So in Exodus, the law was given to Moses after the people were delivered from slavery for 400 years. They needed to know how to live in right relationship with God and with one another. And so Moses is given this law. They needed rules and guidelines to know what it was like to live with the Most High God. And so I want to start in verse 9, and we're just going to hit a couple touch points, or we're going to comb through these quickly. Same thing with Colossians. We're going to comb through them quickly, and we're going to land where Jesus is with his disciples. So in 9 and 10, it talks about providing for the needy among you, the needy and the stranger, by not taking every single crop that grew. And if crops fell, to not pick them off the ground, but to allow others who may not be able to provide for themselves food. In the UCC we were a part of, we did a gleaning day where we picked food for a food bank in an orchard. It allows others to eat when the harvest comes, knowing that you are provided for. And just, I may touch on this later, but it reminds me of a story. There was a family, they had 7, 8, 9, 10 kids, depending on what time frame of the house. Altogether, there were 10 kids, and they would always have friends over. And dinner time came, and the friends started leaving because, you know, 12 mouths is enough. And the father of the house said, "Where are you going?" And he said, "You are going to eat. I don't want to eat your food." And he's like, "You're always welcome to stay." You see, he recognized that when we provide for others, when we live into the Lord's will, he will provide for our needs. And that struck this young man. In verses 11 and 12, it talks about living with integrity. Do not steal, do not deal falsely, do not lie or swear falsely. Live with integrity. As Jesus put it so succinctly, let your yes be yes and your no be no. How many find that challenging? Every day of the week and twice on Sunday. In verses 13 and 14, it talks about not oppressing your neighbor. And I would really like to know what oppression means in the Hebrew context. In today's world, there are more slaves existing right now than ever before in history. And it's not hard to imagine. All we have to do is don't do this. Take your clothes off and look at the tags. China, Vietnam, Thailand. They're not made here. I bet 80% of the things in our homes, if it's that low, are not made here. The way things are mined, we just see the finished product. We don't ask about the source. And doing some reading, you know, I've heard of homeless encampments here. I've heard of homeless encampments in Norristown. Looking up articles on wage disparity. The wage disparity is the greatest it's been since the 1920s. That means that the poorest of the nation, their raises have been like this in the last 50 years. Where the wealthy, their raises have been like this. So there's this gap. And I mean, we know what happened in the 20s and 30s. And when we read the Old Testament scriptures, we see when peoples come into power, even if it starts off healthy, even if it starts off good, when that shifts and it becomes unhealthy and abusive, God has a tendency to level the ground again. You shall not oppress your neighbor nor rob him. The wages of a hired man are not to remain with you all night until morning. They made a daily wage. Has anyone here made a daily wage where you are working day to day? It's rare anymore. It talks about not being partial to the poor or the great, but to judge fairly. You should not slander your people, nor act against the life of your neighbor. Do not slander. Is this how we're known? And it's interesting, it says, you should not hate your fellow countrymen, nor take vengeance, nor bear a grudge against the sons of your people. Do you hear how quiet it is in here? But love your neighbor as yourself. How oftentimes do we want to justify ourselves just like the lawyer? Well, who is my neighbor? Well, how do I do that? God was already anticipating those questions. And if you go just a little further, you know, Church World Services is here today. Thank you for sharing. I look forward to your third son and you screaming his name at the top of your lungs. Please let us know when that happens. We will celebrate with you. Further on, it says, when a stranger resides with you in your land, you shall not do him wrong. The stranger who resides with you shall be to you as the native among you, and you shall love him as yourself. For you were aliens in the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. We are to love the stranger as we love ourselves. We are to love the neighbor as we love ourselves. And I just realized I missed a section. It talks about the deaf and the blind, not putting a stumbling block there for them. You know, my grandmother was legally blind. If someone can't see you, you need to acknowledge them because they can't see you. So you need to acknowledge them and make sure they feel connected. God was setting out these guidelines, this foundation, so that people knew how to live with him as the Most High God. A holy, set apart people. He was letting them know what that looked like. So then you turn to Colossians and you have Paul. And leading into our section, it says in verse 9 through 11, do not lie to one another. This sounds familiar. Since you laid aside the false self with its evil practices and have put on the new self, who is being renewed to a true knowledge according to the image of the one who created him, a renewal in which there is no distinction between Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, and free man. But Christ is all and in all. Put on these things like you put on your clothes in the morning. So as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on the heart of compassion, kindness, humility. Are these needed today? If followers of Jesus put on compassion, kindness, humility, is that how we're known? Nationally, regionally, locally, in our own circles? Gentleness and patience. As someone who loves truth, I struggle with gentleness. And it takes me time and learning and people calling me out. I hear some of your voices in my head that compete for all the other voices in my head. When I'm going into a difficult situation, be gentle. And it's interesting, when you listen to these words, it changes your approach, it changes your posture, your stature. In our culture, when we go into a discussion, an argument, What is our posture? We're gonna win. And yet Paul says, put on the mind of Christ. You see, you can be gentle and meek and not sacrifice truth. You can be compassionate and loving and allow the Spirit to convict. One is not devoid of the other. Bearing with one another. If you want a happy home or if you want a good friendship, tell your loved ones, I'll bear with you. Oftentimes it's the other way around. You know, we're getting into sticky ground and it's like, bear with me. So I looked up that word in the Greek, to hold one another up. When you bear with someone, it's to hold one another up. Bear with me. Let me hold you up. You hold me up. We'll go into this together. We got to a place where we could save money early on in our marriage, and we loaned a person I worked with money. And I learned after we lent the money, I talked to both my parents, and they both told me, only loan as much money as you're willing to let go. Because then the person I worked with never paid me back, never paid us back. But every Sunday, I'd say the Lord's Prayer. Lord, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And this person would come to mind. I'm like, well, accept. But... And before moving, I went and talked to the person, and I told them this. I think about you every Sunday. And Paul echoes. And forgiving each other, whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also should you. Jeff has this forgiveness practice that I appreciate. When you realize you've wronged someone, ask them, do you forgive me? Can you forgive me? That puts it in their court. They can say yay or nay. And once you receive the affirmative, what can I do to make things right? Anyone's pride dying right now? When I was a kid, you know, my mom would be like, say you're sorry. Sorry. We still feel like that when we're adults? Why don't you go ask forgiveness? Sorry. But then we had to explain what we were sorry for, or I would get to listen to a lecture. I listened to many. Forgive one another as you have been forgiven. And beyond all these things, put on agape. Agape love. This self-giving, self-sacrificing love. And this is the same word that Jesus uses in John 13. And before we turn to that passage, I want to just name one thing. Let the word of Christ richly dwell within you. We read scriptures. We typically read three scriptures throughout our services. Teaching and admonishing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Psalms, hymns. When we think of hymns today, it's typically older music. Some of the stuff we sing is from the 1500s and probably older. And then we sing modern songs because everyone is needed. And music impacts us in different ways. You know, Jamie's talking about the Jesus movement in the 70s, and I grew up listening to my mom's albums. Jesus is just all right with me, the Doobie Brothers. I love that. Jesus, he's my friend. Love that. We're all needed. So we get to John 13. As our sister mentioned, this happens in the midst of the Last Supper. Jesus has bowed down and washed his disciples' feet. It'd be like the president or the governor coming to your house and cleaning your house for you, mowing your yard. And he goes on to say, a new commandment I give you, love one another. Now they already had that commandment. They had that commandment specifically. They knew the love of the Lord their God with all their heart, mind, and strength, to love their neighbor as themselves, to love their enemy. But he goes on to say, and this is the same agape love, love one another even as I have loved you. Keener says, by laying down his life, by Jesus laying down his life for others, Jesus loved the disciples more than his own life. Jesus says, love one another as I have loved you. And this is shortly before he would sacrifice himself so that they understood the fullness of his love, the fullness of the desire that he had to restore them. That his life was less important than restoring them back to the Father and restoring them to one another. What is the most important thing for you today? This is what agape means. To give all. And why is this important? When we show this kind of love to one another, by this all men will know you are my disciples if you love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples. By this men will know. By this men will know. By this men will know. People who don't follow Jesus will see how we treat one another and know that there is something deeper, there is something more meaningful there than anything the world has to offer. In him there is no Greek nor Jew nor slave nor free, Democrat or Republican, Baptist, Methodist, Brethren, Mennonite. Christ is in all and through all. There is no division in the body of Christ. The left and the right were nailed to the cross. And this is a hope, this is a peace that we can offer to all those around us. But we first must show the love of Christ to one another. So my question today is, will you commit or renew your commitment to follow Jesus together? To bear with one another or not hold a grudge? To forgive one another and not badmouth? To love and honor each other. Knowing that in Christ, all are one. Because this world needs compassion. It needs kindness, humility, gentleness, patience. And it can start with us. I love when Dave Bendit shares stories about working at the food bank at the Church of God in Christ on South Ann. Because it's not about that church, it's not about him. It's about what Christ has done and what he's called to do. You see, when we follow Jesus in this way, people will know that we are his disciples. And they may in turn come and follow him as well. Let us pray together. Father, I thank you for today. I thank you for your scriptures that have been passed down for thousands of years by your servants. I thank you for the way the people have sought after and followed after you. Father, we confess these are hard passages at times. But we know that we do not go at it alone, but we go at it with one another, empowered by your Holy Spirit, as we seek to live and grow and breathe in you. So I pray, Father, that you may walk with us now, that men may see our works and glorify our Father who is in heaven. We lift this to you in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's stand and sing our closing hymn. Jesus said, A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Go in peace.
On behalf of Hempfield Church of the Brethren, we thank you for joining us for today's service.
The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.